Oh, she. Oh, goodness, you frightened me. Oh. You must pardon my appearance and the curtness of my demeanor, for I have just been attacked by my own countrymen. Yes, attacked by representatives of the United States Navy in a crude and unchristian display of barbarism. But I am getting ahead of myself. For you to understand the events that I am about to relate, I must start at the very beginning. I'm the Reverend Hiram Bingham, the leader of the Protestant mission in these islands of the Viking. We arrived in the spring of 1820 on the brig Thaddeus and have for several years been engaged in introducing Christianity and civilization to the native people here. The events of my life are irrelevant to my tale here today. What's more important is that you understand what the mission has accomplished here and the efforts of debased men to undermine those accomplishments. This particular incident began in February of 1826, when an American man of war, the USS Dolphin, under the command of one Captain John Percival, first made port in the harbor. Now, the ill will between the crew of the Dolphin and the people of Oahu began when First Officer Paulding insinuated that the missionaries were somehow deficient in their hospitality because they did not, with others of their countrymen, hasten down to the shore to congratulate the crew on making port. He speaks of being disappointed at this, as he had expected that we would be among the first to hail and welcome the arrival of an American man of war. Indeed, it was an extraordinary event. The Dolphin was the very first American man of war to make port in the harbor. And indeed, we were glad for their safe passage. Just because we were not the first to fall at their feet in elation does not mean that we would not have gladly given them the warmest of hospitality that they may call at any of our homes. We hesitated in our welcome because we were ignorant of the character of the crew. We were very wary of their presence due to recent events in the village. Several months prior to the arrival of the Dolphin, a British frigate had made port in the harbor, and the crew immediately began denouncing the new laws the Hawaiian chiefs had passed that forbade prostitution. Over the years, American and European sailors both had grown accustomed to certain pleasures when taking their leisure time in the islands. Thankfully, we have convinced the chiefs that such actions are sinful and spread contagion, and so must be outlawed at once. The crew of this particular ship demanded that we use our influence with the chiefs to overturn the law, and they threatened us with our very lives. How dare they? What had we done to offend them so? Had we not simply taught the natives that immorality of every kind was displeasing to God and therefore injurious to the nation? Had we not simply translated the Holy Bible and the Ten Commandments so that we may spread the will of the Lord to these primitive people? This was the environment that First Officer Paulding and his crew had entered into. Pardon us for being cautious. Regarding the arrival of the Dolphin, First Officer Paulding further insults us with his comments on the crowd that did greet his arrival. He has told others, and I use his very words, that we were very much surprised to find on landing a rabble of half-naked natives, as we were led to believe through the various information we had received that their condition was much improved and that they were far advanced in civilization. He goes on to state that they formed a more varied and fantastical group than any he had ever seen, even where no degree of civilization had taken place through an intercourse with white men. Well, I know not what impressions First Officer Paulding had of the state of civilization in the Sandwich Islands previous to his arrival. I have no reason to believe that any accounts had been published representing it greater than it actually was. The work we have been performing is incredibly difficult. One cannot expect to civilize a population overnight, which it seems is what First Officer Paulding had expected. Though there was much work yet before us, the people of the Sandwich Islands have made remarkable progress. When we first arrived in 1820, the natives were in an uncivilized and most degraded condition. Idolatry had been abolished some months previous, but the belief in the power of their gods was almost universal, and some continued to offer sacrifices. The land was barely sufficient to furnish food for the population. The people were universally addicted to drunkenness, theft, debauchery, infanticide was so common that from the last estimates which I had made, more than half of all infants born were put to death by their own parents. Theft was as common as the opportunity to commit it. Licentiousness everywhere prevailed. Murder was sometimes committed with impunity. Indeed, there was hardly a crime which they were capable of committing of which they were not guilty. It was frequently repeated to the missionaries by those who knew the people that you cannot civilize them. Oh, no, 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 they are too bad. They will never abandon their ways. Well, within 2 years of our arrival in the islands, we had made ourselves so far acquainted with the language as to reduce it to writing in an already published a small spelling book. Some of the natives were able to preach to their own people in their own language. At the time of the dolphin's arrival, the vices of the drunk and the gambler with which the land was previously almost overrun were reduced to a comparatively small number. The observance of the Sabbath was universal. Schools had been established in every part of the island and attended by some 2,500 scholars, among whom 40,000 tracts containing verses of scripture had been circulated. Nearly all of the chiefs and leading persons of the island, as well as many of the inferior classes, had been taught to read and write. The thousands who had formerly devoted their time to drinking and gaming, quarreling, practices of iniquity in all its varied forms, the thousands who had wasted their time in idleness, were now daily assembled in schools, reading scripture, and spent their leisure time listening to instruction. All who could afford to purchase clothing were glad to dress in the English fashion, and many had been taught by the females of the mission to furnish their own garments. The land was being cultivated to a far greater extent than formerly, and provisions could be acquired at a price far below what was being asked during the first 2 to 3 years after the establishment of the mission. The trade has been constantly increasing in the islands. Vast quantities of Chinese, English, and American goods are annually sold to the natives by American merchants, who at the time of the Dolphin's arrival operated 6 stores in Honolulu, as compared to only 1 prior to our arrival. These are the islands whose inhabitants First Officer Paulding referred to as having made little advances towards civilization. But none of the assertions of the Dolphin's crew can compare to the vulgar actions that have taken place this day. In his report, Captain Percival makes mention of a riot that some of his men were involved in. He insinuates that he and the other officers quickly reestablished order before any serious outrage could be committed. I am inclined to disagree with that assessment. It all began on February the 26th, 1826, during Sunday service. Some 3,000 souls were gathered in the congregation, including a few officers of the Dolphin and 2 or 3 seamen. They behaved with decorum, but after the meeting, some of the chiefs had mentioned that they thought that they had evil designs in their hearts. Well, I thought little of this assertion, as they had behaved with decorum, and apart from one particular incident of extreme rudeness from Captain Percival, in front of the chiefs, no less, they had done little to arouse concern. Now, it rained heavily that afternoon, and so we decided to omit the regular afternoon service. It had been customary to hold the meetings in open air, as we are gathered here today, due to the vast numbers who had attended. Now, at 5 o'clock, I made my way to the enclosure of the chiefs, where they had all gathered for the purpose of conducting worship. And I had just begun my sermon when 6 or 7 sailors belonging to the Dolphin arrived. Now, I kindly told them to disperse. We were engaged in prayer. I would attend to their questions later. It was then that they revealed that they were armed with clubs and knives and demanded that we use our influence with the chiefs to overturn the prostitution law. They behaved with great insolence, saying that they could muster 100 strong men, and unless their demands were met, they would commence to tearing down the houses in the village. After a few moments, they started smashing windows, and within a few moments had smashed all of those on one side of the house. Do please remind me, when we have finished here, to see Captain Percival about having those windows paid for. We finally managed to get them out of the house and the enclosure, and I thought that was the end of the whole affair. Instead, they turned their attention towards my home. What business had they there? Perceiving their design, I hastened to protect Sybil from the ruffians. Thankfully, she had fastened shut the door by the time I arrived and retreated to her chambers. Now, unfortunately, this also prevented me from entering the home, and the rioters were quick at my heels. They roughly seized me and proceeded to drag me through the town, laughing and shouting. I cannot tell you how frightening it was. I thought that they intended to kill me for certain. Thankfully, a number of natives saw my plight and intervened. At that moment, one of the rioters aimed a blow at my head. God bless OPD, a chief woman who happened to be nearby, for she raised her arm instantly and received the blow that was intended to end my life. At that very minute, another rioter withdrew a knife and lunged at me. Another native jumped upon the man and disarmed him. Upon seeing the attempt to end my life, several more natives joined in the fray. Now, the natives were highly excited. And despite the calls of the chiefs not to harm the men, but only to hold them fast, the natives would reply, "How can we hold them fast when they are armed with clubs and knives?" Thankfully, they finally managed to hold down each of the rioters and disarm them. And it's at that moment that Captain Percival came and marched them all off. At that very moment, another group of men who had passed by unperceived made another attempt upon my house. They darted in a window or two, but failed in their attempts to break down the door, though their clubs were heavy and thick, being no less than 2 inches in diameter. I shudder to think that they were intended for the heads of my family. Finding that they could not force down the door, they stood still and waited for Captain Percival to come and march them off as well. Happily, no lives were lost in the affair, which is somewhat remarkable, considering how highly the natives were excited. Several crew of the Dolphin were injured in the attack, but Captain Percival made no inquiries as to whether any missionaries had been injured. I believe that they did at length recover. Now, the following morning, Captain Percival sent for me to go aboard his ship and identify the man who had attempted to stab me. I did, but he denied the fact, alleging that he merely withdrew his knife to defend himself. Defend himself from what? The wrath of a mission reverend. I understand that after I left, the men were flogged. Their true punishment awaits them at the hands of the good Lord. It would seem that the design of the rioters was, in some degree, defeated. A general invitation had been extended to the whaling ship, so it seems that the plot had been maturing for some time. Only 3 crewmen of the whaling ships were found among the rioters, however, the rest all being crewmen of the Dolphin. Now, it was their original design to wait until darkness fell and attack the missionaries as a group. Fortunately, I suppose, a great number of these men grew impatient and departed before the appointed time, and the rest decided not to attack at all, seeing as their brothers had so nearly been killed. It is providential circumstance that prevented the attack from going on as planned, for in such an event, many would have lost their lives. The natives are a kind people, but when their passions are aroused, they are not easily restrained. Some of the chiefs had mentioned afterwards that had such an event taken place prior to the introduction of Christianity, not only the rioters, but every foreigner on the island would have been massacred. Captain Percival insinuates that order was reestablished before any serious outrage could be committed. Well, if to commence in the wanton and unprovoked attack upon the houses of the chiefs and the missionaries, to dart in their windows with clubs, and to attempt to force down the door of a home with the apparent purpose of attacking a defenseless woman then inside, to seize and drag a clergyman from his home, to strike at him with a club, and to attempt to stab him with a knife, the accomplishment of which was only prevented through the interference of others, if all this, when perpetrated by representatives of the United States Navy, in open day, and in sight of the vessel to which they belong, if this be not a serious outrage, then I would be glad if First Officer Paulding would furnish the public with a definition of the same. The result of the attack made by the crew of the Dolphin on the chiefs and the missionaries was more disastrous to the cause of morality than any event in many years. This will be evident when it is known that as a result of the attack, and apprehensions that it will be renewed, the law prohibiting licentious females from visiting ships was virtually repealed. Kalani Moku, the acting regent, was confined to his bed with sickness, unfortunately, and Kaahumanu was less resolute, especially after hearing Captain Percival declare in the presence of the chiefs and the missionaries that he would not leave the island until the taboo was lifted. Oh, upon hearing this, countless numbers of females hastened on board without delay and were greeted with shouts and exclamations of joy. Others, encouraged by this and knowing full well that those of this class would be greatly compensated for their efforts, were quick to follow suit. And thus the floodgates of iniquity were thrown widely open, and the thousands who might have otherwise been saved from ruin were irretrievably lost. Though this was certainly a defeat in our constant battle against the forces of evil, I firmly believe that much good has been accomplished in my 21 years in the islands. Countless souls have been saved from damnation, though many were also lost. Remember this tale as a parable against the wickedness that exists even within the hearts of our own brothers and sisters. Now, if you'll excuse me, I must attend to the villagers. The gospel does not teach itself. Go with God, and good night.